Regardless of your thoughts on our part in the universe, one thing that we can all agree on is that human genetics have proven to be extremely successful. We've evolved from cave dwellers hunting and gathering our food to luxury lives of TVs, cell phones, and ordering in via apps. So we can agree human genetics are fascinating, but what are some of the more incredible facts about our very makeup? In this Sci-5, we look at just that, with 5 incredible facts about human genetics. Before we get started, I just wanted to say that this video was super fun to research, and I loved learning more about the human genetic history as a whole, but the more I researched, the more I wanted to find out about my own personal DNA history. So I partnered with MyHeritage. MyHeritageDNA is a kit that will help you understand where you came from and uncover your ethnic mix, learn more about yourself, and discover new family members. It's the most global DNA source with a huge database from all over the world and 42 unique ethnicity regions. It's super easy to take the MyHeritageDNA test. You don't have to give blood or spit or anything like that. It's just a simple cheek swab. And it's also completely private, and I know that that's a big issue for all of you, so don't worry, I wouldn't use it if I didn't think that my DNA would be secure. If this is something that interests you, and after this video you find that you might also want to learn more about your own personal DNA history, then you can use the coupon code SciFives for free shipping, and I will also link to the kit in the description. With all that being said, let's begin learning about all human genetic history with this episode of SciFives. Number 5. Our RNA makeup may prove we originated on Mars. Anyone who knows anything about the search for habitable planets, or even just simple biology, is aware of the importance of water in the process of life. Water has long been seen by many as the main ingredient in the recipe for life to occur, but interestingly enough, it is also proven to be very damaging to what many consider the first form of genetic replication. This is known as the water paradox. To put this in simple terms, RNA is a nucleic acid similar to DNA with a few differences, including the fact that it is a single strand of nucleotides where DNA is double-stranded. As I stated before, RNA, not DNA, is widely considered to be the first form of genetic replication. But there seems to be a problem when trying to build this in water. It simply falls apart. This is where the water paradox gets its name. Water is accepted as a necessity for life, but it also sabotages the first stage of genetic replication. So how did life ever form? The answer is boron. Steve Benner, an Origins of Life chemist from the Westheimer Institute of Science and Technology in Gainesville, Florida, found the answer to the puzzle in another element. When adding boron to the mix, Benner found that he was able to recreate a stable version of the R, ribose, in RNA. This made it so that the acid did not fall apart and was able to go about its way, spreading life and whatnot. And this is where our neighbor Mars comes into the mix. Geology posed an issue in Benner's findings. According to geologists, boron was incredibly scarce on Earth and would not have been able to support widespread creation of RNA on the planet. But Mars had an abundant amount of boron in the early days, and this is where the puzzle pieces fall all into place. As a result of this research, many scientists believe it is much more likely that a meteor may have struck Mars, kicked up some of the early life forms, and subsequently sent those to Earth on rocks. Similarly, there was another issue titled the phosphate problem. Mars also is and was home to 2 types of phosphates that were also essential in early life, where Earth was lacking these. Because of this, Mars is considered to be a better nursery for early life. So if life came from Mars, wouldn't that make us all aliens? Number 4. Biological dark matter. What can be even more interesting about our genetic makeup isn't what we do know, it's what we don't. And there's quite a lot of what we don't know. Nathan Wolf is an American virologist. During a TED talk he gave in 2012, he explained that if you were to take a swab of DNA from your nose, about 20% of the genetic information wouldn't match anything we've ever seen before. This includes animals, plants, fungus, virus, or bacteria. Nothing. Scientists have absolutely no idea what it is. If you were to sample the DNA from your gut, this percentage of unknown data would increase to about 40 or 50%. This unexplainable type of genetic data is called biological dark matter. Biological dark matter doesn't just find itself in places like our nose or our gut. Wolf also says that in relatively sterile blood, scientists still find about 1 to 2% of the information can't be classified. So you may wonder, is there anything that we do know about this dark matter? The answer is yes and no. In 2014, a team led by Professor Henrik Caseman of UNIL's Center for Integrative Genomics did some research into some of these unknown pieces of our genetic makeup. The team studied long non-coding RNAs, which are nucleotides that cannot be translated into protein, in hopes of finding their function. They were able to get a few answers that may lead to a further understanding of other unknown information. Essentially, through finding a select few gene functions, they were able to determine that some of these genes were used in the process of developing most of our vital organs, after which their purpose would be finished. So yes, we may know a small bit about biological dark matter, but if up to 50% of our genetic data can't be classified, the hunt for more information continues. And until then, just like the space surrounding us, dark matter continues to test our ability to discover the mysteries of our universe. Number 3. Leron Syndrome. We've spent the last two segments focusing on our early genetics, so now let's focus on some of the mistakes along the way to the species we are now. Of course, most of us know that every person with blue eyes can be linked back to a thousands of years old genetic mutation, but what some may not know is that genetic mutations are incredibly common. More than you may know. In fact, thousands of mistakes happen every single day. Most are completely harmless, but unfortunately, some can cause cancer and other diseases. But sometimes, mutations can be an odd mix of negative and positive, and this is the case of those who have Leron syndrome. Leron syndrome can be linked to Semitic origins, with most cases found in those with Jewish heritage. Most patients are found in Israel or in remote villages in Ecuador, where residents descended from colonial-era Jewish folk who migrated during the Spanish conquest. The characteristics of the mutation are quite interesting. Essentially, the syndrome is a type of dwarfism. An affected carrier of the gene will not grow to be normal human size. They also may have a prominent forehead, depressed nasal bridge, underdeveloped lower jaw, truncal obesity, and in men, a micropenis is possible. For women, breasts will grow to normal human size, resulting in disproportion. And in some cases, seizures are common, and in specific variations, there may be a decreased intellectual capacity. These, of course, would be classified as the negative effects of the syndrome. And here's where it gets interesting. To start, patients do not develop acne. They are also exceptionally resistant to diabetes, cancer, and even aging somewhat. They are much less likely to die from disease, but are more likely to die from accident due to their size. In one reported case, a man from Ecuador lived to be 87 free of cancer or diabetes and was in relatively good health. He was unfortunately killed in a car accident in 2012. In a study of 99 Ecuadorians with Leron syndrome, not one died of cancer or diabetes, and in contrast, 20% of their relatives passed away due to cancer alone. The leading cause of death for participants was cardiac issues at 27%, which is not too different from the 21% of their relatives. And the second leading cause of death was accidents at 20%. There's so much more to be said about this fascinating mutation, so if you're interested, I recommend going to the link that I will post below. Number 2. Our lifespan may be limited. If the last segment got you wondering the length a human life could go if accident were not a factor, I may have an answer. At least for humans not affected by the mutation. A gerontologist named Leonard Hayflick from the University of California believes humans do have an expiry date. So even though our medicine and safety continue to get better, our maximum lifespan may not be increasable. This is thanks to the Hayflick limit. In 1961, Hayflick ran an experiment where he observed the multiplication of human skin cells grown under laboratory conditions to see how many times they would multiply, and if that answer was finite. The answer, of course, was yes. He found that they would multiply about 50 times and then would cease to continue, thus 50 becoming the Hayflick limit for humans. To put this into some perspective, the cells of a Galapagos turtle, known for its incredibly long lifespan of 200 years, will divide about 110 times before stopping, and mice cells, who live about 3 years, cease to divide after about 15 times. The longest documented human to live was a woman named Jeanne Calment of France, who lived 1875 to 1997 and died at 122 years, 164 days. The 120 mark is, for most, seen as the barrier for human life, and thanks to Hayflick, we may have reason to believe that that will never change. But is that really so? Some argue this may not be true. The Hayflick limit is only the limit of cell division. It is not the exact limit of years to live. In this case, correlation may not be causation. If this limit were to prove the limitation of human life, then it would be safe to assume that a 60-year-old would have less cell division than a 20-year-old, right? Well, in experiment after experiment, this does not seem to be the case. As we've been able to see, skin degrades as we age simply because our body cannot carry out its normal function of repair and regeneration. So is this possible to fix? Can we increase our lifespan? Unfortunately, we don't know, as the topic is heavily under-researched. So for now, our 120-year barrier will live on. Number 1. We all may have descended from one common female ancestor. If you ever feel like you don't have enough in common with someone, as a last resort, you may want to consider this. Your genetic heritage may come from the very same lineage as every single person you've ever met and ever will meet. In fact, everyone in the world today may have one common ancestor. This common ancestor is a woman dubbed Mitochondrial Eve. In 1987, a team of geneticists published a study that proposed this theory. The researchers examined mitochondrial DNA from 147 people across all of today's major racial groups. Before I go any further, I'll explain why they chose to examine this form of DNA. Mitochondrial DNA is passed on only by women, as the eggs they carry that form of DNA. Men do not pass along this type of DNA, as their sperm carries only a minute amount, which dies upon the race to fertilization. Mitochondrial DNA contains very important information, and can be found replicated throughout your entire body. And since it can only be passed on by one parent, it does not combine to create a mix, meaning your mitochondrial DNA is the exact same as your mother's. This makes the DNA much easier to trace. And that is exactly what these researchers did. They were able to trace the lineage of all the study participants back to a single woman who likely lived about 200,000 years ago. The study also found that she would have lived in Africa. This is because African lineage is the most diverse. Researchers reasoned that this is because there is more time for mutation than any other racial group. In fact, African lineage is so diverse, the researchers categorized lineage of all people living today into two categories: African and everyone else. So this African woman who lived about 200,000 years ago is the common ancestor of every living human. And for that, she was granted her name, Mitochondrial Eve. Now, to clear up an obvious question, aren't humans more than 200,000 years old? This can mean she was the first human, can it? No, she was not the first human. It was really just luck that her DNA passed so easily, and a big part of her luck came from the near extinction of humans. Many times in human history, humans have faced near extinction, leaving few to repopulate to continue the human race. In fact, about 70,000 years ago, we were reduced to just about 15,000 when a volcano eruption was so large that it lowered global temperatures and spurred the coldest ice age in human history. Given that the margin of error for Mitochondrial Eve's lifetime is between 50,000 and 500,000 years ago, it's possible that even this event left her as one of the few procreators humans had left. Thanks for checking out This Sci-Fi. If you like this video, don't forget to like, subscribe, and turn on notifications. Also, check out my last video, 5 Mysterious NASA Livestream Cutouts. And be sure to stay tuned for future sci-fives on all things science and science fiction. And again, I'd like to give a big shout out to my Patreon supporters, specifically my new ones, Michael Benindestel and Glenn Hargis.